And we want to talk about warnings, but really, warnings are a forecast of severe weather. If you waited until the event has occurred, you didn't warn somebody. I mean, eventually you can have a warning, and downstream that's all a good thing. But really, severe weather warnings, tornado warnings, severe thunderstorm warnings, they're a forecast, and they're something that require anticipation. You just don't do those just out of the blue just because there's some mechanical process that you can look at and go, okay, I need to do this and this on radar, boom, that's a tornado warning. There's a lot more that goes into it. The main takeaways is that you guys are the most important part of the process, how you process information, what your backgrounds are, how you come to make conclusions, really is what runs the whole the warning forecast process. It should start days in advance, and sometimes radars lie. Not every answer is always the obvious answer, even when it's in radar data. So we'll try to cover a bunch of this stuff as we go on. I don't know if any of you guys familiar with the Myers-Briggs. You're shaking, a few of you are. It's really an interesting tool, and I'm sure there's others that are out there, but I think it's important to know kind of both who you are and who the others that you're working with, because ultimately, if you're in an operational weather environment, it's going to be in a teamwork effort. And undoubtedly, you're going to annoy the heck out of someone that you're working with, or someone is going to annoy the heck out of you. Not out of on purpose, just because we are all wired with these different strengths. And so when you look at these categories, this is a way to break down how we process information, but there is no just black and white switch. That's why I've kind of shown this as a continuum. And for you guys that haven't taken this, we can make real quick tests around the room on who's what. Like, you guys can all point out right away who the extroverts and introverts are. Y'all, if I said right now, you could do that. Your instructor might be one of those extrovert people, or at least one of your instructors. And what's interesting about that is that extroverts tend to process their thinking verbally oftentimes. And so they are chatting, they're processing what's in their mind, sometimes in an audible fashion. Extroverts get energy from their interactions. Introverts, on the other hand, will tend to be quieter. So if you come up and say, do we need a warning on that one? And you walk up to an introvert, if they're not totally prepared for the way you interact with them, they're going to freeze for a little bit and go, because they're not going to want to give that question, that answer right away, because they want to process it all internally and then present it to you. That can make the introvert look not so smart to the extrovert, when really the introvert might be the smartest person in the room, and they just express themselves differently. So how we interact is different. I try to be cognizant of that as the MIC when I come into a warning operations, just because, for one, if you're the boss, people tend to get a little bit more nervous if you're looking over their shoulder, if you interact with them. But I know the extroverts, I know the introverts, and if it's an introvert, I try to come in and I lower my voice a little bit just to try to be a little less excited. Even though there might be tornadoes dancing outside the window and I'm going to charge in there like Ariel would, on that case, hey guys, you know, there's like a tornado in the parking lot and we don't have a warning out. There would be, you know, we probably should go ahead and ramp this up. So there's ways that we try to adapt our communications sometimes with each other. I think these middle two things are really get to a lot of how we truly make decisions. There's the sensor intuitor and the thinker feeler. The sensor is the person who likes hard data. They need to be able to see, touch, smell, whatever that they're looking at to be able to make a decision. Where the intuitor works more on instincts. They don't always remember every threshold that was involved. And so when it came to like working out some of this stuff, like, I know exactly what I'm looking at here, but it's going to take me a little bit to go get some of the details back. And so two different ways to do it that. Is one better than the other? Well, you know, if you're in a warning situation, let's say, and you've had your training and your whoever has taught you that 35 knots rotational velocity is an important number for a supercell tornado warning at, say, 20, 30 miles from the radar. So you're sitting at 33 knots rotational velocity. Well, the sensor's like, I gotta have 35. Where the intuitor's going, oh my gosh, we're sitting here we've got a decently turning mesocyclone in a decent environment. Can we not get a warning out on this? And so we think of things differently, where the sensor may want to hold a little bit. It's like, I need that threshold met. Where the intuitor's like, the basic package is there. I'm sorry, we're two knots shy of this, but. The other part of this is the thinker-feeler, and this is basically where decisions are made more from a feeling or more from logic. So you get, and I don't want to say that feelers are illogical, but the thinker is going down generally a logical progression of things, where the feeler is more in tune with what are the potential impacts here, what's not going right And so they're going to be more in tune to that. I like to joke sometimes that some of the feelers in the office that they see puppies ahead of all supercells. And so you can just see them getting nervous as they see that storm heading towards these storms. Like, but there's puppies ahead of it. And so warning decisions by that person are going to be made in a different fashion than the sensor person that's sitting there looking at these thresholds. Imagine if you combine how you crosswire the two. And I think this can be important too. Like you can have the sensor but crosswired as a feeler. That feeler is going to see the puppies, but they still kind of want the thresholds, but they're torn by seeing the puppies. And the same thing on the intuitor thinker side, where I'm more into the pattern, I'm more into the gut instinct of it, but it better be logical. And so the things balance. The other thing, the judge perceiver, the main part about that, as I see it, is in the whole scheme of things, especially about warnings and about weather, is how you manage your time. How many of you, you don't have to admit to this, but how many of you either know or yourself can just leave on a 3 or 4 day vacation and never call ahead to where you're going? Just like, we're going to Colorado and I'm going to take off. How many of you need to know where you're going to stop, at what time you're going to stop, what restaurant you're going to? If you're that, then you're the judge. If you're the perceiver, time is less of a constraint. And so you can imagine that in a warning environment where you know that tornado warning expires at 4:30, and the judges are going to know that. They're going to just know that, unless they've gotten so tunnel vision that they've lost in the meteorology. Where the perceiver is going to be like, so when do these warnings expire again? So we all come at stuff differently. So it's not because one version is smarter, one mix is dumber, whatever. It's just that's all how we are. And so if you understand how your personality works, you can overcome some things where maybe you are that sensor and you just got to have 35 knots before you warn. And no, it doesn't always work that way. And you need to be a little more open. So it's just things to consider as you make warning decisions and things to consider as you interact in a warning environment. Now, as I said before, issuing warnings starts 2 or 3 days before the storms. I think that's really important because you can follow trends. You can watch our model data. Are they moving in one direction or another? And you can also begin, I just start looking at hodographs and soundings a couple days in advance, trying to imagine, are we going to have cell splits? When I draw a polygon, is it going to need to be bigger on one side than the other? How is all that going to work out? Because if you can anticipate that in advance, it goes much better because you don't have to make these emergency, oh, the tornado suddenly did this now and it's leaving my box and I hadn't even considered the fact that it might go right or left at some point. And so anything you can do to make a decision easier when you're really, really stressed, because at some point it is a stressful thing. You're with all the science, all the technology we have, it still comes down to a human decision. And so it's still something where you're looking at that and you're like, I got to make a call. So looking at that, anything in the environment 2 or 3 days in advance helps, and it leads you into the event so that you can watch the trends. And I was also try to think, what's the worst case? Like tomorrow, there's a slight risk now over most of the Tulsa forecast area. It's a wind and hail thing. But I automatically am thinking, but how could I make a tornado tomorrow if there was going to be a tornado tomorrow? Just don't blindly accept it's a wind and hail day and we should be good. I always start worrying about how can I get to a worst case? What would I need to see to change some of that? So I think that's something I think that you just have to consider going into it.